Yes.
One of the nice things about being the preacher is I get to tell you about mine. The good and the bad. Anybody have any bad things happen at your house on Christmas? Well, if you did, you're not saying, which kind of goes right along with the sermon, doesn't it? Every year after Christmas Eve, me, Chris, the staff, sit down and make a list of all the things that went wrong with the Christmas Eve services. And there were a few. But I'm thankful to God that most of you have no idea what they were. You know, it's kind of like the cook. You're eating the meal and you're going, hey, this is good, and the cook's apologizing. I never understood why my mom did that, you know, until you look back and you're in charge of something. On Christmas Day this year, my father-in-law fell three times. He had a stroke about 12 years ago, and it kind of introduced a very painful discussion in our family about how to take care of Grandpa. I was not at in-laws for Christmas because the young people that live in our house was at the emergency room on Christmas Day. And, you know, it's the doctor's office isn't open and urgent care isn't open, so if it's bad enough, you just have to go there. And they said to my lovely wife, we've seen this all morning long. It looks bad, but it's just a virus. Take him home. So then we have the incident of the barbecue sauce. You ever have those moments where you just count to 10 and it's not enough? So all the food comes in for Christmas and all the extra things, and it's all jammed in the fridge. And you happen to be the one that goes to open the door. And this is a half gallon. I'm serious. It is a half gallon of barbecue sauce from Bill and Mary Irons. It's big. And I open the door. And I'm not going to say anything about why it was put where it was put. I know a whole lot more about what happened when it hit the bottle on the bottom shelf and just kind of went poof, in the door, behind the stuff, in the drawers, under the drawers, under the fridge, on my pants. And I said, thank God, praise God, it's Christmas. It's a wonderful day. And I thought about finding the person responsible and saying all sorts of things, but I think I exercised some restraint. And I guess if that's the worst that happens to us on Christmas, it's easy to put some of that bad away and focus on the good. Let me tell you some of the good. The day after Christmas, I went to a particular store that has 50% off on all their Christmas goodies. And I got there at 6 o'clock, right when they opened, and I rushed with everyone to the Christmas goodies, and I bought something I have always wanted, the plastic Holy Family. Mary and Joseph and a baby, got all three, included the baby for $22.95. So now if you drive by our house next year, got the Holy Family. Now, the donkey was $6 extra. I bought the donkey because every family needs a donkey. Christmas cards. You know, I want to thank you for the cards and the notes and the gifts. You all are very gracious, and Christmas is a wonderful time to express love, and my family, we want to thank you. I noticed in a lot of the Christmas cards, a lot of you are getting old enough that you don't want to be in the pictures anymore, just the kids are in the pictures. And yeah, here's one of the kids has a black eye. I guess he didn't want to be in the picture at all, but he's there. All year long I hear about dogs. Stupid dog, blah, 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 dog, Jeff, find us a home for this dog. But you know what? Almost every Christmas card, family has a dog, dog's in the picture, right? Big old red eyes, but he's in the picture. Here's one. Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year for mom and dad, daughter, other daughter, and a new baby sister due in June. You know, there's a lot of joy. There's a lot of good. Lots of wonderful things. Last Sunday morning, Jennifer Biggs preached. She did a great job. Be sure and say thank you to her. And I was sneaking off to get a donut. And I'm going down the hallway, and I hear out of one of the classrooms about halfway down on the right side, this excited voice. And the angels said, glory to God in the highest. And I peek in, and here's one of our Sunday school teachers, right? And her hands are up, and with all the animation that a person could, is telling these little kids. And the angels, they said, glory to God in the highest. And I looked a little further, and there's five little five-year-olds, little bitty ones, just lined up at the table, hanging on every word. And I thought, the story's still being told. From a young age, they're hearing about it. The glory to God. Man, you'd have been so proud of your church to just glimpse that one little moment. This is before Christmas, but I was talking to one of my youngsters about what they should get Dad for Christmas. And I said, Dad doesn't need any presents. And they said, no, I have to get Dad something. And I said, fine, get Dad nothing, but go with Dad sometime over Christmas to help at a homeless shelter. And this young person that lives at our house said, Dad, that's not a present, and I will do that with you anytime, anyway. And I thought, on Christmas morning, you know, when the kids get older, if you give them things, they take the things back. So you get them some things and you give them some money. Okay? Secretly ahead of time, into the three envelopes, which are not labeled, I put two with the same amount of money and one with half as much. Because I am an ornery guy. And on Christmas Eve morning, somebody gets done with their presents. And they kind of have that, okay, what am I going to do now? And so I point to the tree. And this one reaches up and takes one of the envelopes out and opens it up. And it's the short one. I have no idea how this is playing out, right? I close it up, put it back, take another one. Takes the other one. It has twice as much. Puzzled look on the face of young person who says, which one's for me? I said, take whichever one you want. And said young person puts the big one back, takes the small one for her or his self. And I was never so proud to be a parent. I told you about the bad things first, because there's always more good if you look for it. It's one of the tricks of life. One of the truly spiritual things of life is choosing to see the good. For years, I have shied away from Luke 2:19. Can anybody quote Luke 2:19? Don't put it up on the board. It's right in the middle of the Christmas story. You've never heard a sermon on it before. Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. I always been thinking about this. I can tell I don't have a lot to think about, right? I'm thinking about this. And the first thing that comes to my mind is this is not a normal adult woman with child as we think. You know, married person, maybe 24 and she has a child. No. They got married young. This is somebody who's 15. How much can a 15-year-old ponder? And she's got a lot of bad things to think about. I am not married. I'm having a baby. I am afraid. Part of me is afraid of the responsibility of this whole business. Lots of bad things for little Mary. And I'm sure in her pondering, she thought about them. But there's a lot of good things too, isn't there? I have a part in God's plan. God has chosen me. I am the mother of the Savior of the world. The Bible doesn't say, but I would like to think, I would like to believe that in Mary's life, she focused more on the good and the glory and the joy and the happiness instead of the pain and the embarrassment that is also a part of that story. I have a friend who's in this service who likes to say, there are builders and there are what? Destroyers. There are builders and there are destroyers. In life, there are those who choose to see the glass half empty. There are those who choose to see the glass half full. Walking into exactly the same circumstances, there are those who will pick something apart, and there are those that will see the good. I've told this story quite a bit in the last month because it's a great Christmas story, and here it is. Mother and father had two sons. And one was a pessimist and one was an optimist. And they couldn't figure out how to get the pessimist to be more optimistic and how to help the optimist be more realistic. They decided that on Christmas Day, they were going to give the pessimist all the presents and the optimist just one present, and a nasty, painful present it would be. So Christmas morning, all the presents under the tree are for the pessimist. And one after the next, he opens them, and of course, they're all the wrong size, or the wrong color, or this really isn't what he wanted, or his friend has one like that. There's something wrong with every single gift. They try to get the optimist to open his one present. No, no, I'll wait till brother's done. Since I only have one, I'll wait. Finally, brother's done, and he's unhappy with all of the loot that he's collected. And the optimist brother opens his one present, and some of you know the story, to find a box full of dung. Yes, you heard me right. Can we say that word in church? And he starts to hop up and down. He's so excited. He picks it up. He throws it here. Woohoo! His mom and dad, they look at each other and they go, what? What? How? Son. How can you be so happy? You have one present, it's a box of dung. He says, oh, with this much dung, there must be a pony nearby. You are getting ready to start a new year. And I'm not going to tell you, you need a new outlook at church. Because y'all are very positive and constructive at church. But I want to ask you to think about if there aren't areas of your life where you need to see the good instead of the bad. Need to see the joy instead of the pain. On the way out of 8 o'clock, someone said, I've been praying that in 2007, God will help me see the flowers instead of the dirt underneath them. Some people ask God, why are there thorns? Someone else thanks God for the roses. Each of us have a choice of what kind of a person we would be. Paul says, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable or excellent or praiseworthy, think about these things. He also says, as you learn and see these things in me, do them. I'm so glad Paul wasn't perfect. He wasn't. He was a human being. He was an apostle, but he wasn't perfect. He had a thorn in the flesh. We don't know what it was, but he prayed that God would take it away because it made him appear human to people. It was something he struggled with. He didn't like how people saw him because of this thing. And I would encourage you, whether it's the leaders of this church or some of the leaders in the electronic church community, you know, if you look long enough, even in the most famous and wonderful leaders, Joel Osteen or Adam Hamilton or whoever they are, you're going to see something you don't like, but we have a choice to see the good. Paul said, follow me. I don't think he was saying follow me in the bad things. But what you see where I am lifting up the things that are glorifying to God, that's the bandwagon that we want to get on. Now, I want you to know today, this is a very, very spiritual thought. I should thank you. It's the last Sunday of the year. It is the least attended Sunday of the year. And look at all of you who are here. Give yourself an applause. And if you said, I came here on the last Sunday of the year and I'm just getting kind of, you know, the leftovers, no. It's a very spiritual thought. We don't tend to think of spiritual this way. We tend to think of spiritual as, dressing up and feeling honored and looking honorable. How many of you had Sunday school pins when you were growing up? I looked at them on eBay. Whew, they're expensive. I have no idea what happened to mine. You know, how well we can pronounce biblical names. How well you can pronounce Mesopotamia. How you can weave scriptures together. How many answers to great theological questions you might... These are things that we sometimes gather to ourselves and say, I feel spiritual. But folks, I want to tell you something. You can have all of that till you're blue in the face, but if you're a negative person, it's a very unspiritual place for your heart to be. Something that we know about Jesus, he was all about seeing the good. Think about just about any story that you know where Jesus meets people. He meets the woman at the well. What does everyone say about her? She's a prostitute. What does Jesus say? Would you like some of the water of life? He saw her as a worthy person. In John chapter 8, the woman who's caught in adultery, what is all the people around? Stone her! Kill her! What does Jesus say? Wait a minute. All of you who are without sin, cast the first stone. What is he saying? This is a human being. This is someone that God made, that God loves. He looked into places where humans didn't see good, and Jesus saw the good. People shied away from the lepers. And Jesus walked up to them and touched them and healed them. Can you imagine how scary that was for average people? I don't want to hang around them because they might get some of that leprosy on themselves. Jesus went right into the middle of that stuff and he healed them. And how about the people filled with demons? Some of them they kept out of town, chained up. They were such frightening people. Jesus steps right in the middle of that stuff, and he sent the evil away, and he called the good out of those people. One time, Jesus was confronted by a scribe or a Pharisee or someone like that. Teacher, what's the greatest commandment? And Jesus said, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. On this hang all the law and the prophets. What's he saying? This is one of the core truths of the Christian life. How we love one another. How we treat one another. Don't you want other people to see the good in you? Then let's think about in the coming year being those who see the good in others. Psalm 22. God inhabits the praises of his people. You know, I talk to people all the time. They don't feel close to God. They're broken. They got complaints. And I listen to them, and I mean, the glass is half empty. I mean, I'm just listing from the painful stories. Psalm 22 doesn't say God inhabits the negative attitudes of Christian people. That God dwells in the hearts of those who are unhappy. No, God inhabits the praises. And don't think the psalmist only had good things happen. He chose in the midst of difficulty to offer praise. And I will tell you, when you choose to do that, when you choose to see the good, when you choose to give thanks to God for who he is and what has come to your life, even the bad things, God's presence rushes in with that. If I'm focusing on the good things about you and telling you the good things about yourself, God's presence rushes into that. The joy just comes with praise. Had lunch with someone who I think is old enough to be my father not too long ago. They were telling me about everyone asks them, why are you so happy? Don't you want that kind of life? Don't you want to be known as that kind of person? Hey, why are you so happy? Why are you so happy? Why are you so happy? He said, you know, as we've gotten older, you know, the body's aging. I watch my friends, they're negative. I can't do it. There's so much good. I have to see the good. What's the answer to why am I joyful? Why am I happy? I choose to be happy. I choose to see the good. I choose to focus on that which leads to a life that is full and fulfilled. On Christmas Eve, in between services, I was making the rounds of the open houses, and with a short amount of time in between, I'm wolfing down a ham sandwich and some shrimp, and I get entered into a discussion with some folks at a table about how much their that was just a great service. They loved the service, and what a nice church it is, and I asked them why. Why do you like your church? Well, everyone's just getting along. And there's so much good being done. And I thought, you know why? Because people are focusing on the important things. You know why it's been such a long, long time since we've had a church fight? Because you all are engaged in doing the things that churches ought to be doing. You are teaching and leading and loving and embracing and picking up the needy and reaching out in mission. The reason you're a great bunch of people is because you don't have time to focus on the negative. You're so positively engaged in doing the good. So, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if there is anything that is excellent or praiseworthy, think about these things. And what did the last part of the verse say? The God of peace will be with you. If you want to know God's presence in your life, if you want a different 2007, see the things that are good. See the things that God has made that are wonderful. Look past the things that you don't like about your life and embrace the good, and God's presence rushes into that positive attitude. When we do this, the God of peace is with us. Let us pray. Lord, I now pray for myself and for any and all other people who may be here who have caught themselves lately focusing on something they didn't like instead of on what they did. And Lord, I just pray that you would open our eyes to see the glory and wonder of your presence, the glory and wonder of the gifts of life. Help us to be engaged in healing, in embracing, and loving. Help us to be less human and more Christ-like. And so inhabit our praises, fill our lives, our homes with your joy and grace. In Jesus' name we pray.